Welcome into the Monday episode of the David Hookstead Show. Happy to have you all here as always. It's been a little bit since we last saw each other last Thursday. A lot has happened in the world, and we're going to get into all of it. We're going to get into it. Everything, we're going to break it all down. Today is a very fun one. I'm very excited about this. Let's start first and foremost with the National Fraternal Order of Police just hammering the hell out of the NFL. So if you remember last week, it was revealed in a Fox News report, I believe from Peter Hassan, who is a former caller guy himself, that the NFL had donated to at least three anti-police organizations, okay? Now, these organizations could be defund the police, could be disband the police, one of which, let me pull it up here, they gave three, I'm reading this right to you, right from the article, they donated $300,000 to the Oregon Justice Resource Center. The other two were the Vera Institute of Justice and the Community Justice Exchange. So the NFL, through their Inspire Change program, donated money to all three of those, which are anti-police or have anti-police viewpoints as organizations. So the National Fraternal Order of Police, Patrick Yost, if he's watching this and I mispronounce it, I apologize. National president released a scathing fire statement to the NFL for this bullshit that they're doing. And I'm going to read you part of it because I think it's worth reading. I don't usually like reading out big chunks of text on the show, but I think this is good enough. It's worth it. I find it incredibly ironic that NFL teams travel and play every week under the protection of law enforcement. We have officers in stadiums, parking lots, and even on the sidelines to ensure the safety of the players, team personnel, and of course the fans. The NFL pays for this security because they want their venues and attendees to be safe. Now we learn they are sending thousands of dollars to a group whose mission is to end policing and our justice system. How irresponsible is this? If it weren't such a serious issue, we would just laugh at them and go about our business. But make no mistake, this is a very serious issue. Later in the letter, the National Fraternal Order of Police claims that they tried to reach out to the NFL on multiple occasions to get some kind of agreement together where they could work together to heal any broken divides that might be in communities across the United States. And ultimately, the NFL rejected that, instead deciding to donate money to groups that want to defund the police. And quite frankly, this is sickening to me. I mean, it's nothing short of absolutely pathetic. It's disheartening. It's disturbing. It's disgusting. The fact the NFL has chosen to side with organizations that want to defund the police, that want to, you know, essentially leave our communities to the jackals and the wolves at the gate, is horrendous. I mean, what does it say about society in 2021 where the NFL, this an organization that's supposed to be, you know, all about America, it's the all-American organization, the all-American sport, the NFL, the most popular sport in the country, has donated money to organizations that want to disband and or defund the police. To me, we're living in fantasy land, folks. Defunding the police is one of the stupidest ideas in the history of mankind. Now, see, it's easy for rich people to sit back behind their gates of their closed communities in their mansions out in the woods, wherever it might be, far away from the center of cities, far away from danger, and say, yeah, we don't need the police. They're going to Monday morning quarterback this thing. They're going to tell us how the police are bad and all that bullshit. Listen, folks, if you live in a city or you live in any area where there's crime at all, you don't want the police defunded. If anything, you want more police. You want good cops on the street doing their job to deter the bad guys from feasting on those who can't protect themselves. The job of the police is to protect the community. Now, obviously, not all police officers are angels, just like any other job. You have bad people, but the overwhelming majority of police officers, and I mean the overwhelming majority, like 99% of cops are good people who have a difficult job. They get pissed on by society nonstop. The people are ungrateful for the risks they have to endure every single day. And because 1% of them, less than 1%, might do something bad, we want to defund the cops. Are you out of your fucking mind? You really want to live in a society where you pick up the phone when someone's breaking into your house and the police aren't going to show up? There's no one to call. And look, a lot of people, I want to be careful how I say this, but if you have money, the police aren't nearly as important to you. Why? Because you can live in a situation where crime is pretty much non-existent. You can afford the best security. You can afford private security. You can arm up. I mean, it's the same thing. People who want to take away the Second Amendment, they really want to disarm poor people, poor minorities, poor people in areas where there's not a whole lot of resources. I mean, rich people are always going to be fine, folks, or at the very least, they're going to be the last ones to have a problem. This whole idea that defunding the police, taking away the Second Amendment, I mean, make no mistake, the same people who want to defund the police hate the Second Amendment. So not only do they want to take the police away from you, they want to take your guns away from you too. They want you disarmed and completely unprotected. They want you at the mercy of the criminals and the thugs and the gangsters and the violent felons out there who would rape, pillage, steal, rob, and kill your throughout your communities without a second hesitation. We don't need to be defunding the police. We need more police. We need more money for training and equipment. We need more money to hire even better police officers to make the job more enticing. That's what we need. We don't need the NFL donating $300,000 to an organization that wants to make our communities unsafe. It's absolutely crazy to me that this is the world we're living in. What is going on? I seriously don't understand. Who stops and thinks for more than 5 seconds about what will happen when we pull the police off the front lines and thinks that's a good idea? Look at the cities around the country that have defunded the police and cut back. The Twin Cities is essentially a war zone. Chicago, the cops have their hands tied to the point they can't do anything. It's a bloodbath weekend after weekend. The police in this country are not only necessary, most people have no idea how difficult of a job they have dealing with shithead criminals day in and day out. And instead of saying thank you and we'll get better, you know, thank you and we'll figure out ways to get even better at what we do, we have these morons who want to take their badges, take their guns, replace them with social workers. If some guy breaks into your house with an AK and starts laying lead down, you think a social worker is going to come and talk about it? No. If I'm at the point where I'm calling 911 and I can't deal with the situation myself, you better believe the people I want to show up, they better be fucking armed to the teeth. I want them to have ARs. I want them to have handguns. I want them to have the exact same stuff I have. Because guess what, folks? If I couldn't deal with the problem, the people showing up to take care of it are going to need some hardware with them. And these morons and idiots promoted and funded by the NFL trying to take your police away from you. Make no mistake, folks. I'll probably be fine. I live in a setup I'm not that worried about it. It's not that big of a deal. We have multiple layers of security. I also come from rural Wisconsin. People know how to take care of themselves there. This ain't about me. The poor people in this country and people who don't have those resources, when they take the police away, they're coming for you. You're the ones who will pay the price for these liberal dumbass ideas about defunding the police and leaving our cities at the mercy of criminals who wouldn't think twice about raping your children and murdering your entire family if that's what it came to. And the only thing stopping them from doing it is cops with badges and guns and you and your Second Amendment. And I cannot tell you enough how important it is you refuse to give up either. Don't let them take away the cops. Don't give up your guns. And when the criminals come knocking on your front door, you do whatever you got to do to get rid of them. We will not live in a country where we allow ourselves to be ruled by the mob. The violent mob will never be allowed to rule us. And by taking away the police, you get one step closer to that. We cannot tolerate it. We cannot allow it. And it's absolutely fucking disgusting that the NFL would ever send one penny to organizations who want to disarm your communities and want to leave your children and your daughters and your sons and your grandparents and your wife at the mercy of violent thugs. And Roger Goodell should get on TV and he should apologize for this because it's absolutely unacceptable. And that's all I have to say about that. All right. Speaking of the NFL, as we all know by now, the Jacksonville Jaguars have fired Urban Meyer after a humiliating 2-11 start. The problems just couldn't stop coming out. Then he does an interview with Ian Rappaport where he apologizes to Jacksonville, but then gives some of the most unhinged quotes ever about how society's gotten too soft. People are fragile. They're not team first like he is. Urban Meyer needs to read the room, folks. I have never seen a coach have a worse fall from grace in my life than what we just saw from Urban Meyer, right? That was absolutely unreal. He went from winning 3 college national titles to being viewed as one of the greatest coaches of all time, ever, in the history. He was in the conversation with Nick Saban, and I mean, viewed better than Dabo Sweeney. And now he's been run out of the NFL. He's been embarrassed and humiliated along the way. And now he's talking about how society is too soft, too fragile. They just don't understand. Look, Urban Meyer's not a good dude as far as I can tell. Might be a good football coach on the X's and O's. particularly not a good dude. And I'm going to bring up two examples. There was that Brett McMurphy story of the unnamed college coach said, if you ever find yourself in a big fight, stand next to Urban Meyer, because there'll be so many people punching that guy in the face. I think he said everyone hates that motherfucker, that no one's going to be paying attention to you. And secondly, apparently the Jaguars Wednesday, they had a team meeting, or the coaches had a staff meeting. Urban Meyer didn't show. They didn't even bother to go find out where he was. When your own assistants don't go look for you when you're missing as the head coach from a meeting you need to run, that tells you all you need to know. They don't care. You're done. You suck. You're terrible. You're gone. And now Urban Meyer will probably never coach again. What team, unless a college team gets really, really desperate, what team is going to hire Urban Meyer? I don't see it happening. It's hard. You know, I actually thought there was a chance Urban Meyer, being a former Florida coach, he would be welcomed by the community. He would inject some life into it. That never happened. The team hated him. His coaches seemed to hate him. Out after 13 games, maybe the most entertaining 13 games ever. Just wild. All right. Speaking about crime and bad people, we got a couple of stories here. On DailyCaller.com, you can go and watch the video of a teenager in Philadelphia shoots a robber in the face from about 6 inches away. The robber was in a pizza shop, tried robbing this guy's mom from behind the counter. Allegedly was choking her. Kid pulls out a handgun. Now, he did struggle to get it out of the holster. It was not a smooth Raylan Givens draw. He struggled to get the gun out of the holster. He's 14 years old. But once that gun came out, once that weapon was unholstered, he let it fly. And he put this gun right to this guy's head. No hesitation. He didn't even stop to think about it. Blasted the dude. Blasted him. And the craziest thing is, I actually don't know the update. The guy was not dead as of Friday. He was in critical condition after getting shot point blank in the face. And you know what? Like I just said earlier about the Second Amendment and protecting yourselves, if you go into a private business and you start choking a woman and her son is armed behind the counter, guess what? You're probably going to get shot. If you go into a business and you start carrying out violent crimes and someone there has a gun, guess what? You're probably going to get shot. If you don't want to get shot in the face, don't go places you don't belong and try to commit violent crimes. Don't choke women at the counter. Don't try to rob women running the cash register. And guess what? You probably won't catch a bullet to the face. Instead, this moron learned the hard way that if you play stupid games, eventually you will win stupid prizes. And this stupid prize came at his face at about 1,500 feet per second. And I don't know how he survived. That to me is nothing short of an absolute miracle. But damn, if you don't want to get shot in the face, don't commit crimes. Speaking of that, crimes. It feels like we have more and more people waking up to the nonsense that is the media in this country. I'm a huge fan of Tim Dillon. I think Tim Dillon's podcast is one of the most entertaining. I listen to him, Andrew Schultz. There's a few. I listen to Sagar and Jetty's Breaking Points, but that's not really a comedy thing. I listen to Joe Rogan. Those are about the four podcasts I listen to: Breaking Points, Joe Rogan, Tim Dillon, Andrew Schultz. And I'm not a big podcast guy, so I don't have time for a bunch of it. Those are the four. But Tim Dillon in his last podcast was talking about the Waukesha Massacre. I want to pull up his quotes here. He was talking about the Waukesha Massacre, which was carried out allegedly. You got to say alleged. What was this guy's name? Daryl Brooks. And this is what Tim Dillon says. Okay, Tim Dillon, great comedian. I encourage you all to listen to his show. It's absolutely hysterical. He's a straight shooter. He said, "We had the Waukesha Massacre where the SUV that was not being driven, it was a self-driving SUV, killed all those people. No, it was a black guy steeped in anti-white kind of racist language, right?" Skips forward a little bit. "The mainstream narrative is that a car decided to mow over children in Wisconsin." And then he adds, "The guy, from what I know, seemed to be a radical, and the ideology that radicalized him was an ideology that was kind of like dehumanizing white people. Like white people are all out to get you, evil, trying to kill you. Well, if you say that about any group of people and someone believes it, they're going to do horrible things, like drive a car through a parade." Now, it's not popular with the media because the media likes to play footsie every now and then with that ideology as well. So that's in his last episode, starts about an hour in. He's now the second comedian podcast host who said this. Andrew Schultz said this during a conversation with Charlamagne, that the media is completely misrepresented. Daryl Brooks is accused of driving over children and grandmothers at a Christmas parade, killing six people, wounding dozens of other people, and the media is essentially completely silent on. Could you imagine if a Trump supporter or a white Republican in general ran over six grandmothers and children and killed them and then killed dozens of other people, there'd be congressional hearings on. There'd be national lockdowns. There'd be riots in the street. You know, people would be going, politicians would probably maybe even get arrested. They would blame every Republican in the country for it. And yet this guy, Daryl Brooks, allegedly murders six people with a vehicle. His social media history apparently indicates that he's incredibly racist. He holds radical views, and the media doesn't want to cover it at all. No one wants to talk about the fact that six innocent, beautiful souls were murdered in Waukesha by a man. That's my home state. I'm from Wisconsin, as you can see. Was murdered by a man that holds reprehensible views about other races. Why is everyone ignoring this? And to Tim Dillon's point, you know, it's easy to gin up rage against that group of people because it's good for clicks. And the media likes doing it. Now, all of a sudden, someone that holds incredibly radical racist views murders six people. And they don't have anything to say. Let's not remember the Charleston church shooting. That racist scumbag is going to get the needle in his arm, as he deserves, because if you murder people with racist intent, you deserve to die. I'm pretty anti-death penalty, but I do make rare exceptions. I think that if you behaved like an animal, like a rabid dog, or like a rabid raccoon, or rabid coyote, you do deserve to die. And I don't understand, quite frankly, what's that different from the Charleston church shooting and the Waukesha massacre. They were both done allegedly. Now, the South Carolina shooting is convicted. You don't got to say allegedly there. The Waukesha massacre was allegedly done by a man that held incredibly racist views. Why are we treating it like it's any different? That makes no sense to me. Is consistency not a thing anymore? So I give props to everyone who's speaking up. The media should be ashamed of itself for not covering it. But it's a tragedy. And Daryl Brooks, if found guilty, deserves everything that's coming to him. All right, last thing here. So Yellowstone, episode 8 of season 4, aired Sunday night. Watched it with my girlfriend. Love it. Started off kind of slow, but it is laying the groundwork for two things. Number one, obviously Jamie and his dad are going to get into a huge blowout battle of some kind. That's coming. In the preview, they show Garrett and John in the same place. Second, and I did love when John came in. There was the shooting at the diner. And Rip shoots the guy in the foot. John blows him away with the rifle. And I think he says when he's got the woman in front of him, he says, "You think that's going to fucking save you, you coward?" Oh, it was great. But secondly, Monica is pregnant. And I think what you're going to see here now is Casey has a decision to make. Does he go back to the ranch, or does he really commit totally to his new family with Monica? Here's the thing. When I interviewed Kelsey, who plays Monica, she hinted at a very dark ending in season 4, a big cliffhanger. That makes me think Casey is headed back to the ranch and he's not going to stay with Monica. I don't know. Just my thoughts. All right. 1883. Now that it's out, I can tell you all about it. I did have the opportunity to watch the episodes very early, so I've known about what's coming for a while. I didn't want to ruin anything. I actually wasn't even allowed to say anything. They did send me a really cool gift package, which I really appreciate. It was really nice. But here's the deal, folks. 1883 is incredible. It's an outstanding show. Tim McGraw, Sam Elliott. I love the first two episodes. It's even darker, grittier, and sinister than Yellowstone. The thing with Yellowstone is you always feel like at the end of the tunnel, the Duttons have a way out, right? They have a way out at the end of the tunnel. There's light there. I don't get that sense from 1883. Now, we know one of the Dutton males is going to have to get to Montana. That's where they settle. Is it going to be John Dutton, Tim McGraw's character? Is it going to be the son? I don't think we know. I don't want to spoil too much, but it's an awesome show. You all need to be watching. It is every bit as good, maybe even better than the start of Yellowstone. That's a bold thing to say, but it's good. Anyways, that's all we have for the Monday episode of the David Hookstead Show. Make sure to check back Tuesday for an all new one.